Sleeping bags, snowshoes, and axe, and booties for the dogs are all mandatory for the Iditarod. Something that is not mandatory but is good to have for the dogs are bowls, a cooler, a vet bag, the dog's jackets, a shoulder coat, and a wrist wrap. Some of the food that the dogs eat during the race include beef fat, fish, lamb flank, horse meat, beef, regular dog food, and chicken skins.
Before Patrick leaves or just gets to a checkpoint, he has to do certain things. One, grab something to drink, like coffee or water. And then he has to give his dogs a pre-run snack. He then has to scoop the poop, because if you don't scoop the poop, you don't get any mushing done. Then he preps for dinner, for his dogs and him. Then he has to boot up his ding. After he boots his team, he gets ready to hook up the dogs. Then you clear for launch. And then you're off to the Alaskan wilderness.
Some checkpoints include Anchorage, Anvik, Campbell Airstrip, Cripple, Eagle Island, Eagle River, Elm, Fairbanks, Finger Lake, Galea, Grayling, Huisla, Iditarod, Kaltak, Nick Lake, Koyuk, Koyukuk, Manly Hot Springs, McGrath, Nina, Nikolai, Nome, Nulato, Ophir, Rainy Pass, Roan, Ruby, Safety, Shagulik, Chetulik, Skwitna, Dakotna, Tanana, Uniklet, Wasala, White Mountain, Willow, Yetna, and Yetna Station Roadhouse. In Anchorage is where they include a parade for the mushers and their dogs. Arrives in Anvik while Martin Buser leaves.
I got more than 7 this year. No, I really haven't had much of a game plan or a goal this whole trip other than to have a smoother run than I've had the last couple of years and get to know more than 7 dogs like I've done the last couple of years.
Quack! Thank you. All right. No visiting yet. All right, there you go.
Cripple is one of the bigger checkpoints. Here, Martin Buser talks as he leaves Cripple.
The race is incredibly competitive. I mean, like 200th place and doing a camping trip, but I probably couldn't be any further up if I tried. Not with the circumstances the way they were. But yeah, it's I think the first rookie, which is really not a rookie, sneak in 30th place. And he's a very serious, experienced racer in Europe.
Feeling better?
I'm feeling better. My sickness was not really the main reason for me not being up there. It's probably more the lack of preparations for this race. I didn't quite get ready the way I was hoping I could. Then you stare reality smack in the face, and they say, I'll go, and I'll just maintain a leisurely pace if I can, and we'll see what happens.
Nick Pettit was 7th into Caltag. Zappa pulls into McGrath for a break. Another dangerous condition to keep in mind is the freezing cold temperatures and the temperatures from above 50 degrees Fahrenheit.
Traveling. Yeah. But, and you know, I feel really blessed to be here with 16 dogs that are eating and, you know, look good, seem to feel good.
Some mushers run the Iditarod, and with that, they run risks of snowfall and ice.
Well, I kind of planned to stop here, then I changed my plan, and then I changed it back again. I thought it might be the same as yesterday where it got really, really hot in the afternoon and the dogs needed to rest out of the heat.
Not to mention the fact that the track is 1,000 miles long. As you can see, it starts in Anchorage, but the real starting point is in Willow, and it goes all the way through Alaska, right past the sea where you can encounter ice, and ends in Nome. When sleeping in the Iditarod, sometimes you have to encounter dangers.
I thought before, you know, before I started really getting into distance mushing, that I knew, like, I've been tired before. I was a university student. I've pulled some all-nighters. Like, no. Like, you have no idea. You know, and it's physically impossible to keep your eyes open and to, It's just kind of, it's an uncomfortable feeling in that, you know, and because you're so afraid to fall off the sled or, you know, lose your dog team. And so that's why it's scary, because, you know, you don't want to lose your dog team. You want to feel like you're in control at all times. And last year, I found that fresh air was the best to help me stay awake, but I got a little too much fresh air, and I pretty severely frostbit my face. Like, I, you know, if I felt a little tired, I just, like, pushed the roof back.
There is a lot to encounter on the Iditarod, but one of the most important things to watch out for is dangerous conditions. Some of these conditions include temperatures from above 50 degrees Fahrenheit, snowfall and ice, the trail can be slushy and wet, wild animals encounter, not to mention the fact that the track is 1,000 miles long, the snowmobiles, not getting enough sleep, wandering animals, etc. This just proves that you do have to be careful when running the Iditarod.